The Old School Rewind Podcast. The podcast about breakdance music.
So why is it got to be so damn
tough? Hip-hop and old school. The roots of electronic music. The Roland 808 and freestyle. This is the Old School Rewind with Randy Bubba Black on the Podcaster Online Network, Facebook.com. Search Old School Rewind and subscribe now at iTunes with all links at oldschoolrewind.com.
Enjoy episode 24 with Moana from the Jets.
You say a one for the trouble, two for the time. Come on, y'all, let's break
this. Hello there. Aaron Goodwin back again on the Old School Rewind Podcast. Old School Rewind Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, at Old School Rewind. Of course, on Stitcher, iTunes, iHeart, YouTube. This here be the show that focuses on the golden age of dance and hip-hop. And because of you, if you go to iTunes, podcast, and music, we've been hanging right around the top five. Turning the world on to this format that took over the world and took over the radio. And frankly, I didn't invent it, but I was there. I love doing this, Moana. I love talking about old school. I've been playing country music for so long.
Yeah, that's crazy. We actually got hired to open up for Kenny Rogers in Hawaii the first time.
Oh, he's great.
About 30 years ago. And we get there, and they had two mics and a guitar stand. And they were like, where's the mother and daughter? And he said, the agents, they got confused and booked the Jets instead of the Judds. Which was really funny.
No, that's not a true story.
Yeah. Kenny Rogers. We did a show with him, warmed up for him. And they got the Jets instead of the Judds.
No, that's a funny story.
It worked out great. We're from, we're Polynesians, so the crowd was a mixed crowd of, they were a little confused why we were warming up for Kenny Rogers. But, hey, Polynesians love country music, so it all worked out.
Oh, that's a funny story right there.
Yeah.
The podcast focuses on the time between 82-ish to about 89, 90. The more I listened to the music last night, I can't believe how ingrained the Jets are in my listening patterns because of how popular you guys were at that time. And you guys were right there at the front of what they call now rhythm radio. But at the time, you just were a kids' pop group. But
right.
You were creating a rhythm format. Did you realize that?
None of us realized it, but when you look back in retrospect, you can definitely define kind of where the music influence was and stuff. So it's kind of cool to see it.
You guys are a family of how many total now? Have we gotten up to 60 some odd grandkids yet?
Yeah, we're at 65 now, my parents. So the Jets made up the 8 oldest of 15 kids. We also adopted 2 Samoan brothers. So that made it 17 kids.
Your parents are daredevils. Not enough kids. Let's get
They're crazy. Well, they're from the islands. What else do you do when you're on a little island? Polynesians have big families, man. love families.
And Mormons. You're also Mormon faith,
yes.
Correct?
Mormon. My dad was raised a Mormon. My mom was raised a Catholic. So you kind of got the family thing completely embedded.
Moana, when's the first time you remember singing?
Geez, I was probably 7. Six or seven, my sister Elizabeth she sounded like a little Olivia Newton-John, and she was always really nervous, so I was her sidekick. My parents were like, she's scared on that stage, so I was kind of her little sidekick, and then kind of learned along the way how to sing, but Liz was singing at 5, 6 years old. I was about 7.
What were the songs you were singing?
Oh, gosh, a lot of Olivia Newton-John.
But it gets me no. To die, and it gets me nowhere to make
Irene Cara. Donna Summer.
Someone found a letter you wrote me on the radio. And they told the world just how you felt. It must have fallen out of a hole in your brown overcoat. They never said your name, but I knew just who they meant.
Everything from that era, even Marie Osmond, we did a lot of stuff.
Were you guys forced to watch Donnie and Marie as kids?
I don't know if it was forced. I think we were in shock that, you know, they were so... It was because of them and the Jacksons that my parents got the idea to start a family band. So, that's exactly how it started. My parents seen them on a variety show, and they were immigrants from the island of Tonga in the South Pacific. And it was basically... Music always ran in the blood, and we had a little Polynesian review show, but it was... The Jacksons and the Osmonds that inspired my dad to start a band.
Enjoy yourself, enjoy yourself, enjoy yourself for me. Enjoy yourself, enjoy yourself, enjoy yourself for me. Let's have some fun, let's have a good time, you and me. Sitting there with your mouth pulled out, you're sweet as you can be.
He basically put all his money in one place and bought all these instruments and set it up in our little... house in Rose Park, Utah, and basically my brother Leroy learned off the radio how to play the guitar and the drums and the bass and taught the rest. And Liz and I were the youngest at the time, and she sang lead vocals and I was her backup.
To watch the videos of you guys on, say, Bandstand or Solid Gold or Soul Train, I saw, that had to be overwhelming to be on TV, even though you're having success on radio, to finally get onto TV like that and be so many. The writer must have been huge. How many rooms did you guys have to take up when you traveled? I'm thinking about the traveling charges with all you guys in the band.
Well, we were always rooming together, so, you know, it was a crazy time, and we were big fans of music, and it was a lot different. Today, it's overwhelming, all the access that you get to music, but back then, there was Solid Gold and Soul Train and, like, American Bandstand. And we were all fans watching all the other artists on it. So it definitely was kind of like, is this really happening, that we were on these shows? And at the same time, I was, like, 11. So part of me was kind of like, it was just kind of in the whole hype of it, but not really understanding or appreciating it. Now that I'm older and have kids, you really realize that it was kind of like a one in a million thing that not too many artists get a chance to be a part of.
Elizabeth, are you the youngest? Youngest on stage?
No, Moana is.
All right, now wait a minute. The best thing we've ever said, what is your family name?
Wolfgram.
All right, now would you please start with your sister on the end?
That's Kathy.
You know what would be easier? We can do this with this group, because I usually say, what's your name and age? And you're young enough to ask. May I have your name and your age?
Hi, I'm Kathy, and I'm 15.
All right.
Leroy, and I'm 20.
Oh, he's an oldie but goodie, yes.
Rudy, 16.
Thank you.
Moana, 12.
Thank you.
And I'm Heine, I'm 17.
Thank you. Let me you slip over this way a second.
Eddie, 19.
Thank you.
Eugene, 18.
Thank you. All right, now you jump right in here, Elizabeth. This will have to be like a football huddle. Gather around me. I'll just throw this microphone at you. This is not Polynesian music. What did you ever do Polynesian music?
Oh, yes. We used to do Polynesian shows and do the hula and everything.
Did you like it as a kid?
Oh, it was great.
Not that you're an old man now. How did you get into the you know, contemporary pop stuff?
We just switched over. We thought it would be more exciting to reach our goal on the pop side, you know.
I feel like it was luck and hard work and a lot of being in the right place at the right time that helped us, because... You know, there's a lot of talent out there, and we happen to be a family stranded in Minneapolis and doing, we became like a really popular bar band, just kind of doing the local circuit, and got discovered there. And it happened to be right when Prince came out with Purple Rain, and suddenly that whole Prince vibe, the music industry, was looking to the Midwest for talent instead of just the East and the West Coast. And we happened to be there right during that mix, and got discovered.
Are you still Quasar at that time, or in Minneapolis, have you decided to be the Jets?
We were Quasar at the time, and it was our former manager who happened to be a retired Motown rep. He was Stevie Wonder's first manager as a child, as a kid, young Stevie, and then he had managed David Bowie. He retired, and we heard about, I think our agents and my parents heard that he was retired and running his dad's, you know, dealership, car dealership, and bugged him. And I think we made him so sick of all the calls that he finally just ran out of excuses and came out to see us. Don Powell was the man who ended up discovering us in the clubs as Quasar and told us first things first, the name's got to go. Then he found out our last name was Wolfgram, which didn't make any sense because we don't look German.
I don't want to sidetrack you. How's that become? How are you Wolfgrams?
Our ancestors come from Germany. We had a whole, my great-great-great-grandfather came with his three brothers and four cousins. So seven Wolfgrams were merchants looking for a new place to just explore. And they came to the islands and discovered that they could make a business in the island of Tonga with, I think it's coconut oil and stuff like that. And they ended up loving the people and remained there. And those are our grandparents. They came from there. So
I see.
You wouldn't be able to tell by looking at me that I'm German, but yeah, we have definitely have German genes and in our DNA.
Let me ask you, in the 80s, did that become a problem for you to be the nationality you guys were? Did you see any kind of racism? Because there was a pushback against the music at that time, and no matter how cutesy you were or how your age was, a lot of racism going on in the hierarchy of radio that thought black music was taking over the radio.
There was a black department in the, you know, in every record company, there was black music department, and then there was the pop and the rock department, and it was definitely separated from one another. When the Jets came into the scene, we definitely were R&B, but they couldn't make sense of who we were because we looked more international. So we'd go to California, they thought we were Mexican. We'd go to New York, and they thought we were Puerto Rican. We'd go down south, and we were either Spanish, or they thought we were Filipino or Cuban. So in a way, it worked to our advantage that we weren't, per se, known as just a black R&B group. They couldn't make sense, and it worked to our advantage. We had a lot of fans from all different races. And, you know, Polynesians, we're pretty easygoing. We get along with everybody. So it was a blessing, even if there was some racism. Today, it's, you know, R&B music is pop music, and there aren't really any. You know, there's nothing like that today.
Oh, no, there's not. When I hear the racism thing, I mean, you know, with all the political things going on and the word racist being thrown around everywhere, I can remember when, you know, it was an issue to put a song like yours on the radio. And that's a kind of hidden racism I don't think people understood in the music business at that time.
Yeah.
You probably got to see the ugly side of that, too. But you were young and probably not paid. Probably more Leroy finding that stuff.
Yeah, I was the youngest in the band, so I don't think I paid attention. I do now as a mother, but I didn't then, but our base was R&B music, and the black radio got us our start. Our first single was Curiosity.
How's David Rifkin?
David Rifkin produced our record. Don Powell and David Rifkin both were the producers on our, and he engineered all of our first, I think it was our first two albums. David Rifkin helped. And the third two. And it was just a blessing. Don was able to convince David Rifkin to come out and check out the band. And it was different from the other Minneapolis groups. We had a squeaky clean image. But we were hip enough to kind of hang with the others, so it was kind of cool.
Did you ever meet Prince?
Yeah, we actually recorded in his studio, Paisley Park. We're the first video ever made at Paisley Park.
When you're working at Paisley Park, does that mean automatically you get to meet Prince?
You don't automatically meet Prince, but because we seem to cross the line with the people that he worked with.
There you go.
He came in a few times and would listen to the tracks. We'd all be like, holy cow, that's Prince right there. And he'd come in and say a few things. He actually wrote a few songs for us. I never got to hear them. The lyrics and the music was a little suggestive and a little racy. And you're talking about the Jets being ages 11 to 17 to 19. And Mormon. And the producer had told him, you know, Prince, they're a family, brothers and sisters. And I think he just chuckled and said, yeah, I forget about that. So we didn't use any of the material he had submitted, but he had come out a few times, and then we became friends with Sheila E. And every time we would go to California, Oakland area, Sheila would get on the stage with us and perform. And because she's from a musical family, there was a connection there. So anytime she came to Minneapolis, we would meet up and we'd see each other in the studio and stuff like that. But interesting and amazing to be around such talent and a unique style of music from Prince's influence in the Minneapolis area. So the song was Cross My Broken Heart.
Was he pretty?
He is a good-looking man, I'll tell you right now.
Well, 11-year-old girls probably don't use the words good-looking man. Was he pretty when he come in? Oh.
Yeah, at age 44, it's different. Yeah, he was cute. I had two sisters that had the biggest crush on Prince. We're all avid Prince fans, too, and was sad to see that he passed away. But, boy, you still listen to his music today, and there's nothing like that. It's still unique as it was back in the day.
It's still sonically correct, too, along with Michael Jackson's older stuff. That stuff just sonically represents. Madonna, not so much. But sonically, those guys had a real sound with you guys, too. Was that 808 music?
I think they did on a few things, yeah. Our manager helped mold the sound that the Jets became. My brothers and sisters were musicians. I was just lead singing with my sister Elizabeth. So I think we are learning the ropes and what it's like to be a real artist. We were fans of the business and almost happy to be a part of the whole experience. And then as the years went by, we molded and learned just more and more how important it is to be artistic. The second single was Crush on You. Oh, Crush on You came to us, songwriters Aaron Zygmunt and Jerry Knight. And they both had written music for the Breakin' soundtrack, the movie.
Yep.
Breakin'. It came out, it was like I don't know if it was like a cult, breakdance movie. And they had been songwriters for that soundtrack, and they threw some material to our manager. And Crush on You, the first time we heard it, it was crazy live and something we'd never heard. And Aaron Knight could sing. Jerry Knight, he had that high falsetto, and he was like, I could hear your sister Liz on this, and you girls would sound great on this track. But I've always been, yeah, that song stood out right immediately as soon as you heard the demo.
Heard it from my bed. Now, that's my high school music. So I'm not in high school. I'm jamming you guys. You know, you're right there in between in between the breakdance music and the poppin' music. The Jets were helping create that along with Prince and Madonna and the Skritti Politis of the world and, you know, Howard,
oh my goodness,
Howard
yeah.
Jones. I mean, and those type of artists. You guys fit right in there in the pop scene, which had to be incredible. Who did you like to tour with back then? As an 11-year-old, Moana, who did you like to tour with?
We toured with Gloria Estefan on her, I think it was, I forgot the name of the tour. Oh-ay, oh-ay. Oh-ay,
oh-ay. Rhythm's going to get you.
Tina Turner was our first huge legend that we opened up for. And it was kind of a contest between another band. They were huge on Star Search. The show was in Iowa. Nobody, nobody will leave you today. Temptation, oh, 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 pull it down. And Limited Warning was the name of that band. And they said, the Jets and Limited Warning, whoever gets here first warms up for Tina Turner. And we got there first and was able to warm up for her. A few times. Her and B.B. King were the first two legends that we warmed up for. And I think just being in the midst of it all kind of shocks you that you're kind of, you're rubbing shoulders with all these groups that you love to listen to. And today, now that I've got six children. And so now when I look back in retrospect, and we still do shows today with a lot of these 80s groups.
Is that all you can manage with six? Come on, you're Mormon. You could have done better than that. Come on.
Hey, I've been blessed with those six. I have earned every gray hair. I don't know how my mother did it. You know, some people are just born with those genes, and, you know, they're just more fruitful than I could be. So I'm happy with my six. My brother Heine, on the other hand, has 14 kids.
Holy crap!
And he lives in Southern California, and eight of his kids are in a new band called 13 Crowns, and they've just debuted. And are putting out music, but they're from Southern California out there. And yeah, Heine's kind of holding the lead for the most children. Everybody else is kind of running around the average of 3, 4, and 7 kids.
Oh my goodness. So. See, I thought you'd been busy. He's really been busy.
Yeah, he's been busy. His wife just gave birth about a month ago. So
incredible.
So to the number 14. Yeah, it's crazy.
Just a bunch, I tell you, a bunch. Did the LDS community help you guys out from the front, or were you a pop star? Did you make it on your own without the push from that core?
It's always our belief system in our core. We have been raised as Latter-day Saints. We were always just there to worship, but they weren't involved with... Boy, we went hustled a lot for work, looking for work, and my parents were traveling all over the place, from Canada to into the Midwest. We got a little contract that took us there, and we were performing as the regular band for the Hawaiian Inn hotels. So our family would put on a luau every night for these senior citizens that couldn't afford Hawaii. They'd come to the Hawaiian Inn, and we were the family that would host them and entertain them. And, you know, it sounded like a great idea. We did this for 2 years in little cities in the Midwest, from Iowa to North Dakota and Minnesota. And then the hotel chain went bankrupt. And we were literally stranded in Minneapolis. And that's kind of how we ended up in Minneapolis in the first place.
How does a young 11-year-old get subbed into a bar to be able to play? The ABC had something to say about those things, even back then, because they used to squeeze me into the club to play.
Let's see. When we were that young, it was the very last hotel chain, the very last hotel in Minneapolis that kind of felt bad for the band. And the manager had said, look, we'll allow your kids to play if you just play top 40 music, drop the Polynesian show. And if you want to come in, as long as your two younger girls stay in the room, and then when it's time for them to sing, you can bring them out and then go back. The other kids will be, I guess they would be chaperoned by my dad. And that's how they allowed us to perform in the bars, is my dad and mom were the guardians. They would watch the Quasar perform, and then Liz and I, who were like, you know, 8 and 9 years old, would come in and sing and then step out and wait on the side.
Yeah, but none of them were of age.
Yeah, none of us were of age. It's a crazy life, but I think we were good enough that we would pull in a good crowd. We became a popular band that was doing the circuit. And so that's how we got away with it. I would probably never do that for my own kids, but that was the crazy life that I lived. And, you know.
Well, the conflict of being LDS didn't really conflict pop to get you into a bar to sing, because that sort of goes against the religion too.
We were very active we've always been pretty active in our religion. It was our source of income. My parents basically supported the family to do this, and that was our source of income. This is probably why I probably wouldn't do it today as a parent myself today. That influence and that lifestyle is tough on a kid. And there were a few of my siblings that had a rough ride going through that time frame and being around that influence. Then you get into the music business where it's all around you. It's just the promiscuousness of the business, the alcohol, the drugs. Thankfully, because of our religion, most of us have always been able to remain close to each other and kind of clean from a lot of it.
When I hear the word Tongan, I think of your brother Eddie and the size of a Tongan. Is that a myth? Am I just lumping this dumb California boy thinking that all Tongans are large? You guys are small. The rest of y'all were small. Your brother was like the only big cat in the band.
Yeah, he was like he was the big dude. And Eddie is actually Samoan, but most Tongans and Samoans are pretty big people.
Right.
Yeah, Eddie was. We kind of adopted Eddie and Eugene. Eugene and Eddie are Samoan, and they were childhood friends. And one of them was going, Eugene, his family was going through a divorce. His parents were very good friends of my parents, and they just asked if we could bring Gene in because they were having issues with him in his teenage years. And that's how Eugene joined the family. He was kind of best friends with Heine. And then Eddie was a best friend down the block from our house with Roy, and wanted to kind of see the world. And his parents said, well, you can go with the Wolfgrams to Minnesota and come back home. And that's how Eddie ended up joining the band too. But yes, Eddie's our big Samoan. But yeah, Tongans and Samoans are known to be large in stature. Some of us, though, not. But most are.
Hey, it looks like Mom and Dad fed Eddie more than they fed you guys.
I don't know. Eddie was there first all the time. No, Eddie's just a big dude. Yeah.
Has he ever had to slam somebody on the ground? He's your bodyguard on stage, I'm guessing. Easy access from behind the drums. And no, I wouldn't be surprised at all. I've seen it, and I've seen it in more shows. I was doing country. I've seen how people are, and you two young ladies at the front. He had to have had the crow eye right out of the side watching you guys constantly. And if anybody got close, I'm sure that didn't bode well for someone. You got tossed pretty easy or ejected, is my guess.
Well, it didn't hurt to have, you know, brothers that could protect you like that. And surprisingly, of all the boys, Eddie is the biggest teddy bear. Sweet and kind to everybody. And yeah, he's just a happy-go-lucky guy. Surprisingly, as big as he is, he's intimidating. When you meet him, he's kind of a gentle giant, which we love about him.
Those are the ones you got to worry about, the gentle giants.
You got to watch out for. Yeah, you're right.
I saw you on Soul Train. The Prince influence was there for the dancing too, it looks like. Was that just a sign of the times, or was it because you're in Minneapolis? You guys have that same, the elbow down, the moving back and forth.
You know what? We were fans of Prince, and we were proud to be from, you know, the Minneapolis family. Yes, we were definitely influenced by what was around us, and we definitely, when Doves Cry, we took a little snippet from that and was like, we could put our own little spin on it. So I'll admit, man, we were fans as much as we were, you know, just doing our music. We were fans of Prince and his whole influence there.
But he had that Wendy and Lisa band dance thing, and you guys had that. The Soul Train stage wasn't big enough, barely, to hold you guys so you could lip sync for the four and a half, five. What's it like to lip sync when you're a good singer like that and you roll up on a show like Solid Gold or Soul Train?
It's crazy to lip sync to something that you could probably sing, but I think you just get used to it. You get used to it, and you see the reason why they do that, just to keep, you know, the sound. You've seen it when it goes live. Sometimes it goes great, and sometimes it's just a fiasco. But, you know, you have to act. But everybody had to do it, and that's just the way it was. So, yeah, you just learn a whole new way of looking at entertainment when you're in the business and a part of it versus someone who's a fan.
We have the luck of having YouTube now, so we can find all of that stuff. What do you see on YouTube that embarrasses you the most when you go searching around from something back in the day? Do you, something with your hair bad, or were you in a bad makeup area?
Oh,
or
my goodness. I've got a teenage son, almost 17. He's always clowning on our hair. And why was it so big? And, you know, the colors. He's like, man, you guys is mismatched. But, you know, today the fashion's going back to that, where patterns are crossing each other. And so I told him, hey, don't knock it. You'll end up wearing the same stuff we had, stonewashed jeans and, you know, different neon colors. But the hairstyle was probably the most embarrassing part of it.
Sponsored by Aquanet.
For real, Aquanet was just, I can smell it today. That same, yes.
That is so funny. What's the next single to come out after Crush on You?
After Crush on You was, I believe it was You Got It All.
Now the white radio is starting to figure it out. It took a ballad, I think, for the rhythm format to slow down and go, oh, now what is that? At least for me. And that, what year was that?
I believe that was 1987 was about the time that You Got It All had come out.
A monster.
It was written by a songwriter named Rupert Holmes.
Rupert, Pina Colada, Rupert Holmes wrote You Got It All?
Yes, Pina Colada, Rupert Holmes, and our manager.
If you like Pina Colada,
it was a blessing that he wanted us to be a crossover and be adult contemporary, because the You Got It All has been such a blessing to us for people who maybe like the fast stuff. It was the slow ballads that kind of helped give us that longevity and that legitimacy. So Rupert Holmes wrote the song, and when Elizabeth first tried it, she hated it. And I don't know, I guess when you're 11, you're like, I don't get it. Like, I don't really understand the whole, you know, it seems slow and draggy. And he was trying to explain that it's a love song, and she couldn't understand what it meant, the comparison, You Got It All over him, until he compared it to a puppy. And he talked about, imagine if you had your puppy and that one died and they brought another one. It just wasn't the same.
For inspiration, the manager brought a dog and a puppy in so you'd feel the emotion of You Got It All, because y'all are too young to have been through any of that stuff.
Yeah, so that's what kind of helped her get to the whole song. And then You Got It All kind of helped solidify us as we were still legitimately making some success in the business. And with a ballad like that, it crossed over an adult contemporary right away and did really well for us.
Other writers for your songs?
You know what? There was.
It's hard to make money like that.
Oh, it's very hard. Some people, when we first came out, especially family, would be thinking we were rolling in the dough, and we're like, no, we got to go tour. Like us, we didn't understand when songwriters are the ones that make the royalties, and they should, because they created the music, the beautiful music. We are just lucky recipients that we get to interpret it and sing it, and if it's a success, then, you know, everybody wins. But definitely the writers, yeah.
I can't believe Rupert Holmes is swimming in dough every time You Got It All plays, even to this day. It's got to be still number one overseas.
Yeah, and he
still has to be playing in big rotation in those foreign countries. I know how they are. They're 30 years behind us with the music they play. That's got to be one of the biggest when you guys go down into Asia and that area.
It is. You know, Asian countries love slow ballads, so... You Got It All did really well in Japan and in China. You know, we went to the Far East a lot because of the slow ballads, and the Philippines too. The Philippines was one of our biggest markets, and we actually celebrated our 30th anniversary there probably 2 years ago. back in, or 3 years ago, back in 2015.
30 years
because
ago.
They love, yeah, isn't that crazy?
Yeah, no, not crazy at all. Hardworking is what you call that. Hard work, hard work. And your dad, was he overbearing?
Oh, no. You know, with that many children, he had to kind of ring us in. And my mother was actually the more disciplinary one. My dad kind of was a visionary guy who wanted things for us and would step out of his comfort zone to try out stuff that nobody else would. So he was kind of the daredevil, you know, would take risks and try stuff out.
It's sort of a nomadic thing. It's, you know, you have to move around a lot and you got to be ready to sacrifice those types of things. I guess he wasn't afraid to sacrifice that. If you got the whole family out, then we're all together, so we're here. Was that the thought?
Yeah. The neighbors thought he was nuts. Like, you're going to go on the road and be like the Jacksons and the Osmonds? Yeah, okay, crazy guy from the islands who barely has an education. But he was determined to do something with our family that no one else could do, and he could see the talent. And him and my mom just put their heads together and made it work. We had a pretty crazy, adventurous life before the Jets because we were traveling all over the place, sleeping in rest areas, working in little restaurants, and they were just trying to find an opportunity. By 1983 is when we finally got our opportunity and was signed to MCA Records, I think around 1985 or 84.
You're riding high now, and you got it all. Then what?
We released a Christmas record, an album, and then after the Christmas record, we released the second album, and two of the hits from there were, I believe it was Cross My Broken Heart.
I love it. That was the one that really started going at radio right from the release date. I remember that Cross My Broken Heart didn't have to fight like the other singles to get up. They were adding it in at a stronger rotation because I think you were, you know, your three singles in and now, okay, there's something here. And then a sort of a change in sound for you in Cross My Broken Heart.
It was a different vibe, and you're right, the music had changed. Dance music is becoming more prevalent in, you know, the mainstream. The writer on that was Stephen Bray, and he wrote for Madonna a lot. You can kind of hear the similarity with Get Into the Groove and Cross My Broken Heart. But I loved that song, and that was the one where we did our video at Paisley Park. We were the first band to shoot a video at Paisley Park and recorded that second album there and then out into a few other studios while we were on tour. I still love Cross My Broken Heart.
What other single came off that album?
Make It Real.
I love the ballads. Not that I didn't like the others, but the ballads really stuck out in that style that you guys were doing. The ballads really stuck out. Make It Real. Those are 808 songs. So
yes, 808. That's, definitely 808.
Was it confusing you guys to start in with the drum machines being a live band or having people starting to electronically take over the music?
No, I think that, you know, there was synthesizers and all kinds of music in the 80s that people were trying out. We, you know, all different. The music was changing a lot, and there was a lot of synths. So on the road, we were a live band. We used a drum machine. My brother used one to help fatten the, because everything was so fat. All the tracks were always so loaded full of, like they, you know, they just made everything double. So we used the drum machine in our live show just to fatten up the music so that, like Crush, it has so many synthesizers and then the drums and then there's a Simmons kit. So yeah, we weren't at all bothered by the 808 sound and stuff. It was just part of that culture during that time. Hear me cry.
What came after Make It Real as far as the hits?
I believe it was Rocketeer.
Well, all that I can say, baby, I can rock it to you. Honey, the only thing I can do. Oh, baby, I can rock it all night away. One thing I know I can do. I can rock it to you.
So Rock It to You, is that the only time there was a male lead on any of the Jets' hits?
Yeah, yes. And Rocket to You actually was nominated for a Grammy in 1986 or 87. And so Crushin', you got it all. It was up against Kool & the Gang, and I forget who else, and Kool & the Gang won for She's Fresh.
Oh.
It's pretty awesome. Be like, what? Kool & the Gang? Of course you want to win, but man, to be in the same...
We're in the same line, yeah.
Yeah, it's right. Pretty cool. So Rocket to You was what was the boys' first time to kind of make... They had sung certain songs on the tracks on different albums, but it was the first one to come out for the boys, and it was a hit and was a Grammy nominee. There was another song called I Do You that had come out too.
I can't believe the almost blue humor that you have a brother that's a redhead, and when you're on Bandstand, Dick Clark goes up and says, hey, why do you have the red hair? And he says, oh, I think it was the milkman or something.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that kind of shocked all of us.
Oh, my gosh. Poor parents were probably going, oh, no. We say that at home. It's a joke.
So Eugene was always the joker, and he was always unpredictable, also a very charismatic, as you know, he was a very charismatic entertainer. So yes, Eugene made that joke, and I never understood that joke. I was like, I don't know what, I don't get it. You know, you're 11. I get it now. Yeah, everybody cringed. Everybody cringed that understood that, so that.
Your LDS background, it's just not a way to joke. That's something that the LDS don't joke about.
No, and Gene was unpredictable in that way. He unfortunately had left, was taken out of the band after that first album.
Why?
Now that I look back and after speaking with him, we had no idea that he was, my dad and my brother wanted him out of the band. There were some personal issues they had with him, and... they told all of us that he wanted a solo career, and he was kind of the ham of the group, and so they kind of made us believe that he wanted to leave and exit and start his own band like Wham, and he created a band called Boys Club. With MCA Records, but, you know, after 25, 30 years, you finally realize that like, he was ousted. There was some jealousy issues with the family. And because he wasn't a blood brother, I think he was getting a lot of attention during that time. My brother and my dad made the decision he needed to leave. That's what he told us. We were kind of estranged from him for probably 25 years, and it was very unfortunate because all of us we just didn't know, and we just believed everything that our parents and our older brothers were telling us. But he was ousted from the band, and that I think that comment came out of frustration. He had already known that they wanted him out of the band. And so, yeah, I think he made that comment, like, on purpose.
Really?
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
To hear you say that's kind of crazy, yeah.
Yeah, and it's sad. It's you know, you want to celebrate the history, but there's also the dark times and the unfortunate times, and I believe that he had made that comment because, he told me he had made that comment because of the situation that it put him in, and he had no outlet, and none of us knew. And when you're, you know, when you're that young, you don't know what's going on.
Oh, hold on a second now. So him and Eddie came in together?
Yeah, he and Eddie came in together and started working with us, and then he was ousted.
And then here goes Dick Clark on national TV saying, hey, you got red hair. How come you don't look like everybody else?
Right.
Yikes. Well, yikes.
Yeah.
Moana?
I know, it's sad. It's okay. Sad, but that's kind of...
Well, that there, well, yeah, boy, to hear that, that's sort of an incredible listen, actually, to hear
Well, you kind of understand why he would say that. I didn't really understand the joke at the time. I'm, like I said, I was very young. But now that I'm older and we go back and look at history and we wonder why things happened the way they did, I always told him, why did you do that? Okay. He said, I was already removed from the band. None of you guys knew it. So I was like, oh, that was your outlet.
He felt ostracized. I don't look like them. And then a chip on the show. How old is he at this time?
Gene was about 17.
That's not a good age to handle feelings either.
I mean, it's a tough age. And we always were very close. Siblings, we were all very close. But you never really understand the drama at the time. I think my parents and my older brother, Leroy, would differ from that. And so, you know, you take it for what it is. Eugene definitely was removed, and then he no longer traveled with us. And it caused us to be separated for a good 25 years. Only recently have we been able to hang out and kind of hear what he went through. All the years that we were traveling while he had to remain out of the band, we thought he wanted to be released. And he said, no, I always wanted to stay. So that's a sad and unfortunate part of what happened, especially when you're so close as a family. But that's how life is. We have those crazy ups and downs and things that happen.
No deaths in the band. Everybody's still alive?
Everybody is, thankfully, thank God, we all are still alive and raising our children. And just enjoying life today in a different way. It's like you have this crazy life as a teenager, and then you grow up and the music changes and it's hard to stay in it, and you continue on. You start your family and you kind of see it as, wow, what a crazy time. It was so fun. We learned a lot. There's some things we wish we didn't have to go through.
Were you meeting boys on the road, or Dad had a good grip on everybody?
You know, we were never really out meeting boys. I don't know. We were pretty shy.
I don't mean promiscuous, but, you know, boys will ferret out the cute girls. You're not the one in charge of that. The boys are going to come. They're going to find you. Was it something out on, or was it something real, more close to home, or did you actually, you know, did you get a kiss out on the road, you know?
Oh, you know what? We were so busy in our biggest time of being the Jets. I think it was later. I was like 19, 20, and we had
That's a lot later.
Yeah. I don't know. You go through a life where you don't know if people like you for who you really are, so you just kind of hold back. And so I was one of those that was a late bloomer. I kind of was pretty conservative about that. And you because we were the lead singers, we couldn't really decipher what was genuine or not. But I think the older we got,
sure,
when I was about 19 or 20, I could make real friends and enjoy real friendships. And we weren't in the business. We had been out for a couple of years. And, you know, you kind of sift out the ones that are hanging around just because of the success and the ones that are actually genuinely wanting to be your friend. So that was a blessing in a way, to be able to take that time off. It was a tough time for us career-wise, but when you're a young adult going through that crazy age, it's kind of nice to sift away from the fame and try and find yourself again.
What was it like when you found out Liz had cancer?
Tough one for us. I feel like we were going through a lot of crazy drama, and we had been... Of course, we had gone through MCA Records and done 5 albums. I believe it was 5 or 7. And then, you know, music becomes a crazy switch. Suddenly, you're just not the new kid on the block. 1 minute, New Kids on the Block were opening up for us. 2 months later, we're opening up for New Kids. And then you just see a trend change in music. And then the Jets were just trying to survive. We had been on radio for so long that I think radio took a break from us and we're looking for new people. And we kind of suffered for a few years just struggling. We were also hitting that college age, but none of us had real... We had gotten our GEDs on the road, and that didn't really pursue college interest. And so Elizabeth got cancer during a time when we were going through a lot of toxic issues, just trying to survive, get work, working in these crazy casinos and these scummy bars just to make a living. And a lot of us wanted to leave it, but we didn't know how to get away from it because it was our only source of income. It was the one thing that was that took care of the whole family. My parents didn't work at the time. They basically were managing us. And then the older you get, you're trying to find yourself. And Elizabeth got cancer, and it took a blow for me because her and I were best friends. And I thought I was going to lose her. She got breast cancer the year she got engaged. She told me on the surgery table that she promised herself, you know, after this is over, I'm not going to participate in anything that is toxic to me. I'm not going to get involved in the business. I just want to leave it and like be happy with myself. If I've got a year to live, then I'm going to make it work where I'm happy. And that's kind of her exit from doing music was right after she had cancer. She got married and just decided, I'm not going to get involved. It was very toxic because the entertainment business, you know, and the family dynamics changed. I think we know we love our family, but sometimes the business became first and the relationships in the family came second, and it just took a toll. And Liz just told me, I don't want to participate. I'm going to just bow out if it's this toxic, and I don't know how long I'm going to live. So that's what happened when she had her cancer. She kind of exited the whole industry and decided to just lay low. And then I ended up taking over.
How many years ago was that?
Probably 22 years ago, right?
22 years ago, so she's a survivor.
Shortly after that, she was pregnant with her first child. They told her to abort the baby and because it might affect her cancer, but her and her husband are God-fearing people, prayed and said nope. And after her first one, she's had 7 kids now all together and has been a 22-year survivor of cancer. Yes. Hats off to Liz for being a survivor, and she's a proud mother. Her husband's a running back coach for the Virginia Cavaliers on the East Coast. Happy with her life as a wife and a mother.
Where's your biggest fan base in the States? Is it Utah or Minneapolis?
I think it's kind of a mix.
Is California jump in there in the middle of that?
Definitely. In fact, I think California is kind of the heaviest area for us. We've always been the Hispanic, the Filipino community. Just always gotten a lot of love from the West Coast and California. It's always been a blessing to have people that are like, oh, I was a huge fan of yours. And we did get a lot of work and a lot of recognition from California.
You guys are touring. How many of you tour now?
Let's see. Today, it's a little different. I mean, we're doing a lot of these track show dates with like 7 other
the freestyle explosions.
And
yeah.
And they all change every now and then. They're not always asking for the live band, which is a tough one because we're a band. So a lot of the time, only 4 of us will come out. It's not feasible for the whole band. So we love doing live shows, but as of today, we mostly do a lot of track shows. Every now and then, we do a live show. But to get work is, we're really thankful for. And the fact that our generation grew up and got real jobs and they want to hire their favorite 80s bands, we're happy to come back and work again. And it's funny to go the second time around because all the artists we sing with, nobody has a chip on their shoulder. They've all got kids. They're all happy to run away and be a diva for the night and go home and be with their family.
It was an anonymous thing back then. There was no communication. There was no cell phones. There was no internet. You had to bump into people at your show, and they were worried about trying to get to the top of the chart too. So everybody's in everybody's neck, even though they don't know it. And now 30 years down the road, everybody's a big happy family because it was a creation. It did create a movement.
Yeah.
And the rhythm radio movement now is a family going around and touring track dates at all of these casinos. That's got to be a different dynamic. It's got to be different. And you sing the songs, you know what they mean now?
Yes. It's awesome. We had pizza with New Shoes the last show we did last year. And we're in the lobby hanging out with New Shoes after a show. And More Stay in the Time come in. And first they thought we were fans just hanging around the lobby area because they had like a little bar area where you could order food. And then one of them says, wait, are you guys in the Jets? And one of us say, yeah. He says, what? This is a Minneapolis family. And then we end up talking, and you just see people for just, they're all human. They all got their families, and this is part of their job, and everybody's happy to work again.
The New Shoes people are the ones that turn me on to you.
Really?
Val said you need to talk to Moana. I had already sent an email. I don't know where it went. I don't know who replied to it. But in the process, I also found out that it's not too hard to figure out. You guys have rebranded yourself on Facebook and its socials as former members of the Jets. There's something legally going on with you guys. Can you talk about it?
Sure. Yeah, I can tell you a little bit. Unfortunately, our 3 of our brothers, Leroy, Heine, and Roy, decided to sue me and my sisters and our brother Eddie over the name. And so we had been in a litigation for over a year now, and we're in the middle of settling. So that part makes
Leroy, Leroy is the head of the whole thing. What's he mad about? I don't understand.
In my opinion, it was a power issue. Nobody owned the name. And we wanted to separate management from agents. My brother Rudy is an agent and was also co-managing with me, and things were just getting a little bit fuzzy right there. And so we wanted to just separate it, because when you're an agent, you're getting your percentage, and when you're management, you can give authorization for an agent to book you. And we just felt like the lines were crossing too much. It was like you're conflicting. And because we wanted to separate it, they felt a little bit threatened by it and wanted us to basically oust us from doing any of the shows. So they did. Rudy was signing all the agreements. And because he signed the agreement as one of the members of the Jets, he could basically bring his version of the Jets to the shows. In the litigation, we were under an injunction until it was over to not claim ourselves as the Jets, even though we're the lead singers, or some of us are, and Kathy and Eddie, who were keyboard and the saxophone percussionists. So we kind of had to remove ourselves. And it got a little fuzzy because fans would come to the shows that they were doing and say, wait, we bought tickets with this poster, but
yikes,
who are these people? And ooh, so we had to rebrand ourselves as former members and let the fans know there's been a disagreement. It sucks. And we're hoping we can work it out. But basically, our brothers sued us saying that they own the name. And what we find out is nobody owns the name. And we're hoping that we'll settle on something. So
that's wow, kind of,
yeah, it's crazy, especially when you're a family.
That's sort of interesting. Leroy was, would you call him the lead of the band?
Yeah, my brother Leroy was the leader of the band, who was basically the one that taught everybody their instruments. yeah. So that'll put a damper on your family reunion. So it has been tough because we all are very close, and our children, we want them to all be close to their cousins. But for the time being, you do have to get the business right. And we feel like you just need to be transparent and be honest. And so we're hoping that this litigation will go away and we can settle. And you know what? Time will be able to heal everything that went on. So that's kind of where it's at. We're hoping to settle soon.
What are people looking for on the flyers then? Until you get litigated, they want to go see the artist formerly known as the Jets. Is that?
Yeah. And the thing is, my brothers are performing too as the Jets performing, and we are performing as former members of the Jets until this whole thing is settled. I think we're okay with them performing because they are the Jets. We just had a tough time that they were trying to stop us from performing, because we're the Jets too. And it's unfortunate, but a lot of groups go through this, like the Temptations or the Supremes or En Vogue. And we just didn't think it would happen to us because we're a family. But when you're getting sued, man, you don't even know how to start, especially when you're being sued by your own blood. So I'm praying for a healing, but I'm also praying that things have to change too, you know.
What's the funnest part about touring right now? Who do you like to tour with now? Who do you like to see? Because Valerie and John were some of the coolest people I ever talked to on an interview. And I talked with Prince Marky D from the Fat Boys. A lot of people say he was great. Cosmo D from Nucleus was great. The duo, they were so... Val and John, what a great married couple. What a great story. And how they're still...
They're still thriving, yeah.
It's a whole lot of talent in those two people right there. They have a lot of little tiny talents that folks didn't know about until we peeled the onion back on the Old School Rewind, which we're doing today with you.
Pretty amazing to finally meet up with New Shoes and see them again after so many years. And they are as genuine as it gets. And I think they're like that because they're just real artists. They understand the magic of what music does to people, and not just a persona and the whole flashy fame stuff. We loved working with Evelyn Champagne King. She is a crack up. She's a sweetheart. Everybody that we've worked with so far has been awesome. We were just recently with the Daz Band, and of course, Morris Day and the Time, they're amazing. Everyone's just at a different place.
Is Morris Day cool?
He's cool. In fact, we only seen him a little bit, and then there were a ton of people coming up to him, so he exited and went to his room, but the band is awesome.
He looks a little untouchable. He comes in like the king nowadays. That was his thing then, to come out and
that whole persona. And I'm sure he has to remove himself because of, I don't know, all the attention that comes on him these days. But we hung out with the band. They're awesome. We've worked a lot with Color Me Bad, Good, Humble, Exposé. We worked a lot with them, went on tour with them. So to see them with kids today, and you know, Taylor Dane, boy, this girl is so small, but her voice is just as powerful as it was 20 years ago. And, you know, she's a tough one. She's
Who did you not enjoy back in the day touring with? We can say it now. It's okay.
Boy, that's a tough one. You know, you're putting me in a tough spot. The funny thing is we enjoyed touring with, like, our one of our first tours was with the Rap. It was called the Rap Fest. And we went on the road with all these rap groups from LL Cool J to the Fat Boys. And I think the group, what was it called? Lisa. We worked with her and the Colt Jam. And what's the group that wrote all her music?
Full Force.
They were fun to work with, but they always would warn us, hey, tell your little sisters to leave. Our show is inappropriate. And we bumped into Bow-Legged Lou, and he was like, you remember that? We never wanted you girls to watch our show because it was not appropriate. And we appreciate that. We were only 11. So it's hard to say who we did not like working with. There was a lot of egos flying back in the day, but when you think you're the big cheese up there, you have a little attitude, and then you come back down to earth like everybody else and realize, hey, aren't you just happy to work? It's just a whole slew of, I don't know, you just enjoy all the kind of music you hear, and the fact that you're part of that music culture is kind of an honor that people will come and say, man, I'm a big fan, and you're thinking, whoa, this is Heatwave. These guys sing that always and forever. This is Denise Williams. I think one thing I've learned from this whole lesson is you always have to put the people you love first, and you let that business ride out the way it is. And if it's just not going to be worth it, if it has to be the thing that tears you apart from the people you love. And I think we're all learning that today, that even if you love music, if it takes over the relationships of your family, it's just not worth it. Put it aside. And let's get it right, and then we'll get back and do the music again.
Would you call the New Kids on the Block the Jets killers?
No, of course not.
Was it New Jack that killed the Jets?
I think it was just, yeah, it could have been the whole new vibe had changed. We were on radio for 5 years straight, and our manager had told us back in the day that we're going to have to take a break. We're going to have to turn to alternative work. We were not going to be in big arenas anymore, and some of my family was like, no, we were not used to doing these little hotel showrooms and stuff. We work in arenas, and, you know, the trends change. And after 5 years on radio needs a break from the Jets, and the music changed. And you're right, New Jack Swing had come into effect, and then the grunge era came in. So none of this polished, you know, none of these polished acts that were packaged well was really that interesting anymore. They wanted something more, I don't know, more grunged up and more, different.
Nirvana killed the Jets. The Nirvana killed the Jets. Moana, I appreciate you talking about the early old school days of rhythm radio. That's where I started. I had a love for college radio stations on the weekends because that was the only place we would get fed what was called hip-hop at that time, which really is the golden age of dance. And turned into the golden, and which is now the golden age of hip hop.
Right.
Thank you for your contribution. Thank Leroy when you guys get all your stuff done. Thank Leroy for that Nile Rodgers-ish type guitar that I never noticed he played until I watched a video last night. I didn't realize that there was such a guitar sound there, and it was almost like the Nile Rodgers riffing that Leroy would do.
Yeah, it was like a throwback to his signature sound. I will let Roy know. I appreciate you having me on and want to just take a moment and thank all these fans that have supported the Jets after all these years. Always appreciate the love that they've given our family, and hopefully we'll be in your town, you know.
What do you think about the movie, Moana? Your name has...
My kids are always telling me, man, is that really your story? Because I've convinced them that, yeah, that's part of my story. And no, they laugh. I said, I've been on my own adventure. People used to just jack up my name, but now everybody knows as soon as I say Moana.
Yes,
oh, like the movie?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, it's my name.
Yes.
So, well, did they ever call you A.A. Ron?
Oh, no, that's a funny one. Now, so, yes, and it's Shannon's manager called me that. She's got this guy, he's Caribbean, that takes care of her business on socials.
That's
I don't know if it's
funny.
Her boyfriend or I'm not sure. It's the guy who handles her, and I don't mean in a handling sense, but
right. Right, just takes care of her
All
business.
All right, are you ready, Double A Ron? A.A. Ron, he said. I thought that was funnier than him.
Double A Ron.
I never heard that. I never got that. I got Aaron the Bear. Snoopy and the Red Baron. I think Baron was the only thing that rhymed with Aaron. And Aaron Barron. So I really never had to fight anybody because of my name, because it didn't really rhyme well. Yours is achieving superstardom. You're Moana, for Christ's sake.
Well, it's fun to have that movie out because everybody now identifies that that's my name. It used to be so unusual to hear it. It's very common in the islands, but not here.
Speaking of being Polynesian and all, do you have a tattoo of any sort?
I actually don't, but my sister Kathy does. Oh. Full one down her right leg.
Whoa! That's against the rules. Against the rules, isn't it? How's the weather in Utah, Moana?
It's cold. It's a little frigid now, but you know what? We lived in Minnesota where it was always below zero weather, so I'm not complaining.
Yeah, it's a balmy 50 or 60 here, of course, in beautiful California.
What part? Southern California?
No, I'm in the middle. Stockton, Modesto. So,
oh, right, yeah, in the south middle. We will be in your area. Well, San Jose. We'll be in San Jose soon.
I'm ready. It's coming up.
Next month.
I'm gonna have to come out there and check you guys out.
You'll definitely have to give me a call if you're going to come up.
I'll do it.
And then we're down in San Diego and then Santa Barbara, kind of in the middle of the year. Sacramento. We'll be in Sacramento in
April. That's closer to me than San Jose. So I'll wait for Sacramento to come around. Is that going to be a big Golden One show? Are you guys going to be in a big arena or is it a casino run?
It is going. I'm not for sure where. Oh, it's Golden One.
Oh, yeah. That's the new arena here. Brand new arena.
So we're there with Lisa and... Jeez, who else? Deb, 69 Boys Tag Team, and Stevie B.
He's another nice one. I didn't expect Stevie B to be such a nice guy. He was a nice guy.
Yeah, he's a good guy, and he's got a great band. They're awesome, too. Yeah. Nice people.
Well, y'all seem to be nice, and I think just being on this side of the dirt is enough for every single old school act to be out with a microphone and still have interest. It shows the love that the genre brought to you guys and the love that your genre brought to us. I'm able to meet my radio heroes, and today I got to talk with you, Moana, from the Jets. I love it. Where can people find you on social? Because it gets a little confusing due to your litigation.
Yeah, it's on. We are former members of the Jets. And eventually we will be just the Jets again. But for now, it's former members of the Jets on Facebook. And that information will pretty much take you to Twitter and I think it's Instagram. I try to be involved in social media, but I got too many kids and I'm still learning how to use these gadgets. So Facebook, former members of the Jets.
And how about the current music? You guys have done some music recently. Tell me how that process has been.
It's been awesome. We actually did release a reunited album 2014, and it's on iTunes under the Jets Reunited. If you put up just the Jets, you'll get a bunch of old stuff and some stuff that's not, I wouldn't say was favorable. So look up the Jets Reunited, and that was with all of us, seven original members and a little sister who joined us. And it's got four of our hits remade, Crush on You, You Got It All, Make It Real, and Cross My Broken Heart, remade, and then six originals.
You're going to make money off Reunited as much as you can sell, right? Because now you've redid the songs under your own names. That's not going to be the same. Or does Rupert Holmes still get the largest chunk when you sing that song?
You know what? He will always get the credit for that great song he wrote. But if you want to get the record, then I may get some credit too. And we've written a lot of originals on that one. So if anyone's interested, check out the Jets Reunited on iTunes.
What do the fans think when you go out and some of the people are missing? Are they involved in the drama? Do fans get in the drama?
I think the ones that are diehard fans are disappointed. They really wish that we could just get this thing worked out because they loved us together. That's how it would be, I think, for anyone. So I'm really hoping we can do that. But for the meantime, and just the reality of our situation today is we try to be as honest with everybody, just letting them know these are the shows we're doing. And then my brothers have shows that they're doing. And by all means, if they want to go see the Jets with my brothers, that's fine too. I think I have a few little sisters and a niece that sings with my brothers. One of Heine's daughters sings, and a few little sisters that sing.
I just hate to even hear that. So harmonious all those years, and then to get it to be adults and have to deal with something like that really seems odd. But that's the price you pay in the music business, I guess.
It's disappointing.
Regardless,
yeah.
It's the,
the business does crazy stuff to people. It changes people a lot, and hopefully you hang on to the family and it gets better. That's what we're hoping for, is that we can heal and we can learn that the business shouldn't control the relationships. The money shouldn't control your relationships you have, and respecting each other. You know, we're not 11 and 12. We're, you know, Liz and I are adults. Kathy and Eddie, we all should be respected as equal members in a band that we all started off together with.
Are your parents still alive and kicking?
Yes, my parents are still alive, and they are in their mid-70s now. Mm-hmm. My father is going to be 73. Actually, not mid. My father's in 73, and my mother is going to be 70 at the end of this year. So,
Moana, do you have to work?
For their sake, I'm hoping we can heal this.
Yeah. Do you have to work?
Who, yeah. Me? I perform, and I'm blessed that I can be home. I'm a stay-at-home mom.
Yeah, okay.
Besides doing the music, I'm usually home with my kids, raising them, and then I try to run away on the weekend and be a diva, and then come back, and it's laundry day.
You don't need to
see how it all
You don't
works.
Need to perform, though. You're set. You and your six, and you're married.
Yes, I am. I've been married for.
Right.
I'm going on 18 years
right.
this year, or 19. Going on 19 years.
But everything's comfy for you. You don't have to go out and play with the Jets. Is that what I'm hearing, or do you have to go out on the weekends?
Well, I would love to. It's a big family. We're a big family, but I'm blessed because my husband does work, so I don't
there
have
you go.
To. But I would love to go out and work. It's kind of nice to get out there and do something for yourself, what you did before.
Sure.
And I miss it sometimes, sure. So I enjoy it. I think I enjoy it more. That's probably why I enjoy
well,
it more.
Well, I appreciate all the time. Thank you, Moana, and thank you to the Jets. Hug everybody's neck. Hug Eddie's neck for me, because if I tried, tell everybody that from a young white kid in Central California, you really affected my path in what I chose to do for a living, because I put all my eggs in that rhythm batch back in the day, and only to turn country in 94 when Dre and Snoop broke the radio. I went and turned into country. Not that I like hip-hop any different, but that the format sort of eroded away, and country started paying my bills, and thank you for the music. I appreciate it. I appreciate all those great songs, and to go back through and watch you guys, to watch Leroy's licks, and to watch Eddie, his presence, and to see you two gals, and just everything, the way it was all put together. Had to have been a hard life. I don't know if you would call it that, but it had to have been a very hard way to grow up, even though it was probably fun, and you're 11 in a new city all the time. But thanks for keeping it together, and thanks for putting out great music. That's from all the old school people that listen to this podcast, I'm speaking for them.
Well, thank you so much. That means a lot to me. God bless you and continued success for you. And hopefully we meet up in the future somewhere.
I just have to say,
baby, I can rock it to
you.
Rewind with Randy Bubba Black. Share and subscribe now at oldschoolrewind.com.
Baby, I can rock it all night. One.